elect and so on, the so-called kingdom now doctrine, which shows such a lack of simple biblical comprehension. The kingdom's not a thing we make happen. It's something our Lord instructed us to pray for. As follows, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're to ask God to bring it, not to make it ourselves. But the important point here is, he says, if it weren't so that I was going only to prepare a place for you and come back and take you there, I would have told you. I wouldn't have asked you to carry a cross a lifetime if I weren't coming back for you. I wouldn't say I'm coming back for you and not come. I wouldn't say, wait for me, I'll come for you, and then you're supposed to instead count on some vague messianic age or a time when men are doing peace on earth by themselves in their own virtue and so on. None of that. He said, if it weren't so, I would have told you. Thomas doubted him, as some people doubt him today. And in the fifth verse, it says, Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how could we know the way? Doubting Thomas, who later was to doubt even the resurrection momentarily. Jesus saith unto him, what an answer this is. I am the way and the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Well, let's talk about Messianic Judaism. If the archaeologist has indeed found the first church and it was Messianic Jewish, I know that we have a lot of Jewish listeners, one kind and another. Certainly Messianic Jews tune in our program, but unsaved Jews tune in all the time. I say unsaved or unbelieving, okay? Rabbinical Jewish people. And they don't know much about what they think is a new sect. Jews who believe in Jesus Christ, but all the people who believed in him at one time were Jews. Jesus came to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, as he put it. I'll read Matthew 10, 5 and 6. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He had a conversation with a woman of the Lebanese coast, really, a Syrophoenician woman. And it says, behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. This is a Gentile woman, but she calls him, thou son of David. She's evidently conversant with Scripture. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Strong statement. Actually, as the dialogue goes on, he does hear her faith and heals her daughter. It has a happy ending. But at first, he even said, you shouldn't approach me. I'm the Messiah of the Jews, peculiarly, at least at this point in the gospel. In John 12, when he came down the Mount of Olives, his disciples saw him do that. I read John 12:12. On the next day, much people that were come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, Baruch Hu Haba Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It's so Jewish a thing to do, and they greeted him with, of course, the Jewish formula. And an interesting thing happens there later in the chapter. It says there were certain Greeks, verse 20, there were certain Greeks among them that come up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. And when Jesus is told this, it says in verse 23, he answered them, saying, The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Boy, that's a very strong and funereal thing to say when they merely say people from Greece are wanting to speak with you. Evidently, they've heard of him. They would like to see him. Is it a signal to him that when those of other nations start to come, the Greeks come to see him, that his father is signaling him his mission is over, because his mission, as he said, was to the lost sheep of the house of Israel? It is the apostles who will go to Greece. We will see as our series goes on. Paul and Barnabas and Silas and so forth will go overseas, and the Lord himself did not leave Israel. He witnessed there. So it was a Jewish church that he came to establish, evidently, and Messianic Judaism that he came to start. It's open to Gentiles, I don't have to tell you that. It's open to all. But it was peculiarly Messianic Jewish to begin with. The congregation, who would have gone to church in this little place? Well, that Syrophoenician woman, the centurion whose servant was healed and commended Jesus, the policeman at the cross who said, truly thou art the Son of God, surely. And of the whole universal Messianic Church of Israel, there would have been a lot of people. How about the palm wavers on the Mount of Olives when he did ride the donkey? Thousands of them. I counted up, well, the road from Bethany is 2 miles long. If they stood one abreast and needed a yard of space to wave their palms, 7,000 could stand there. And I think there were more than one abreast. Most artists paint it with people, throngs and throngs, many layers of people waving the palms. Anyway, thousands. And at Pentecost, 3,000 more saved. All Jews, it says in Acts 2:5, there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews out of every nation under heaven. God had slain 3,000 in Exodus 32:28 when the law came down from Sinai because of that golden calf. Now he returns 3,000 souls. What a good bookkeeper. The letter kills, the spirit gives life. In Acts 3 and 4, with Peter's sermon, 5,000 more are saved. That's 8,000 plus the palm wavers. Okay, this is a pretty big church. They say the First Baptist Church of Dallas is one of the biggest, or maybe the biggest. Gosh, 20,000 people. I've named probably close to that for this first church in Jerusalem. They met in people's homes. This church at Mount Zion may have been their holy of holies, their Kodesh HaKodeshim, I don't know. I've gone to church in Jerusalem, church in effect in people's homes. They told me this church has been meeting here since Pentecost. Only the members have changed. Imagine. I've gone to assemblies there where everybody gets an earphone to hear a translation of the sermon. Quite a thrill. It seems that Messianic Jews are waiting for the second coming of the Lord, like all Christians, but rabbinical Jews are waiting for the first coming of Messiah. That is a great big difference and an important one. Well, our offers concern knowledge of this kind. Okay, I've codified this into the Institute of Jewish Christian Studies. It's not that I was born with some special knowledge. We have a course. We put it in kind of with cassette tapes and charts and diagrams and so on, so you can learn it. We even issue a diploma. We stay in correspondence.